Hey, Canucks fans, let's talk about that brilliant overtime from last night's Canucks game. I'm Clay Emo, I'm at Canuck Clay on Twitter, I'm at Clayton Emo on Instagram, I'm the founder of the GLCBC, the good-looking Canucks Positivity Club, and this is my Canucks take, all in one take. It's Clay's Canucks commentary for Wednesday, February the 26th. Last night, you know, for my post-game vlog, I recorded it as I was walking into the bowling alley, and with those post-game vlogs, I love doing them. But because of my structure, what I liked, what I didn't like, and one other thing, it's meant to be only 2 minutes and 20 seconds. That way it's quick, and that way if the entire vlog fits on Twitter, and then I can post it right away, both on YouTube and on Twitter. So in only 2 minutes and 20 seconds, I can only say so much. I can rattle off a few points, a few talking points, and a couple stats, and that's really it. I don't have a chance to expand on things. But I can do that, obviously, the next day. And that's what I want to do today. I want to talk about last night's overtime shift and the way the Canucks dominated that entire 95 seconds. So if you saw my vlog from last night, I actually didn't get to see the overtime go live. I was driving to bowling. And thanks to those who asked, actually, I only won one of my four matches last night. I should have won two, but I choked in the last game. I missed a 7-pin, which would have given me a spare, which then I would have won. So not the best showing. So I only won one of my four matches. And even though our team won the quarter title last quarter, we lost last night to the team that had my two sons, Sean and Jacob. And if there's one team that I don't mind losing to, it's obviously that team with Sean and Jake. So it was a lot of fun bowling on the same pair as them. So we get home, Sean and I watched the overtime its entirety three or four times. And it was brilliant, I must say. Everything from who Travis Green put out there, the first trio was Miller with Pettersson and Hughes. And then the second trio that ended up scoring was Horvat, Toffoli, and Edler. And remember when Hughes joined the team at the end of last season? We got so excited when we saw Hughes, Besser, and Pettersson take the ice for the first time in the extra frame. Just how well they controlled the puck, how creative they were. The passing, the backdoor passes, the chances. And then we still see that to this day. Even though Besser was hurt, Miller is just as good. In fact, he's probably playing with more confidence right now, a better point getter right now. So we saw Miller, Pettersson, and Hughes started off, had a little bit of everything. Hughes kind of did a backhand pass, a blind pass, trying to go behind the net to Pettersson, but didn't have enough of an angle on it, put it right onto Demko. It wasn't that hard, so Demko was aware, but it was still kind of funny as you saw Pettersson kind of looking for the puck. Then they break out, and that's after Miller had won the initial draw. And then that trio dominates play for about 35, 40, maybe 45 seconds. And that included some really good plays. Pettersson knocking clearing pass out of the air. Otherwise, the Montreal forward, probably Domi, I think would have skated onto it for a clear-cut breakaway. So that was a brilliant play by Pettersson. Also, Miller broke up a play at the blue line as well to sustain the pressure. It caused two of the Habs players actually to collide with one another. There's another way the Canucks kept the puck in. And then Hughes had two really good chances. One where he deked the entire team and almost beat Carey Price, but Carey Price made a really nice pad save. And then right after that, Hughes again went to the net. You can do that when it's only 3-on-3 and when you can skate as well as Hughes. But then Hughes was hooked, and then they didn't call a penalty. So all those things happened, right? Pettersson knocked it down. Miller broke up a play. And then the two Habs players collided. So that was three different opportunities that the Habs had a chance to get the puck out, and they didn't get it past center. Then, with the three Habs players still pinned in, and that includes, of course, Jeff Petrie, that includes Max Domi, and whoever the third guy was, I think it was Byron or someone. And these three guys, by the way, didn't get off for the entire shift, those three Montreal players. The Canucks had them hemmed in, and while Hughes controlled the puck, one of those brilliant ones where he takes it in, comes back to the blue line, and then cuts again towards the net. That gave a chance for the two forwards to get off. And then over the boards comes Toffoli and Horvat. He gives the puck up to either Horvat or Toffoli, can't remember who. Then Hughes goes to the bench and Edler comes on. Meanwhile, Toffoli makes another great play, rubs a Habs player out on the boards, and then the Canucks grab the puck in the neutral zone once again. So they make that four chances that Montreal had a chance to clear the puck past center, and they couldn't. Horvat and Toffoli bring the puck in, and then we see what happens from there. Edler to Horvat, and then Horvat, that back pass, behind the back pass across the blue line, it was safe though because all the Habs guys were pinned in, they're tired. Then I think it was Toffoli that skates onto it. Then it goes Toffoli, grabs it to Horvat across, and then back to Toffoli, a beautiful give and go, and Toffoli puts the puck in the net. So a few things I want to talk about really quickly. The four chances that Montreal had to clear and that Vancouver blocked, you know, Pettersson, Miller, Then the collision between the two Habs players, and then Toffoli rubbing the guy out on the boards. Excellent, 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 aggressive and smart, assertive play by the Canucks. Then it's the overtime started off kind of funny when Quinn Hughes put the puck on his own net. No big deal, but that's all Demko had to do for the entire overtime was basically steer the puck behind the net where Hughes and Pettersson got their signals uncrossed, and then they went, and the rest, as they say, is history. It was beautiful. It was a clinic. It was puck control. It was good shooting. It was good passing. It was awareness of where everyone was. And like I said, really, really good defensive play. So all in all, I really liked what the Canucks did. And it was interesting. I always think, you know, who are your trios? If Horvat, Toffoli, and Edler didn't score, who would be your next trio over the boards? Maybe the way the game was going, you could go Virtanen and Sutter, maybe. Although Sutter's not the best out there. But he has played in overtime before. So maybe you go Virtanen and Pearson, although you don't have a center on there. But as long as you're not winning a draw, that's fine. Maybe you go something like Virtanen, Pearson, and Stetcher, who's a really good skater, or maybe even Tanev, who's decent 3-on-3, good positioning. Whatever, the Canucks didn't have to get to that because they only needed the first two trios, and Montreal only had their starting trio that was pinned on the ice for those entire 95 seconds. So, but probably not the best explanation ever, but if you've seen it, hopefully all those things rang a bell. I didn't put the footage, I didn't put this in the video, but if you saw the overtime, I think you know what I'm talking about. All the good plays by the Canucks, the way they dominated, the way they asserted themselves, and they had really good chances. Quinn Hughes had a chance, JT Miller had a chance. All of them had really good chances until Tyler Foley put the puck into the empty net after a great give and go from Bo Horvat. So overall, a really, really good overtime. And I said this in my vlog really quickly. The Canucks showed great resiliency last night, coming back from that early 2-0 lead, the 2-0 deficit that Montreal opened up just 7 minutes in, and then scoring, of course, that third period power play goal by Jake Virtanen to tie the game up with about 15 minutes left. So I wouldn't say the Canucks certainly aren't as good as that 2010-11 team yet, but there are similar aspects, similar feelings in that even though Montreal got up to that early 2-0 lead, I never felt like Vancouver was out of the game. And I just had a sense, and I even tweeted about it after the second period, I just had a sense that the Canucks were going to pull this game out, whether it's regulation time or overtime. Even when Montreal scored 1 minute into the third, you never felt that the Canucks were out of it. And that's a beautiful thing about this team. They're resilient, they work hard, and they get good goaltending. And Thatcher Demko, want to give props to him as well for having a really good game, a good outing, 37 saves as he puts his stamp on the team for the next 3 or 4 weeks. So speaking of which, we'll find out more about Jacob Markstrom later today. Probably won't vlog about it. It's my church day, but maybe do an update, unless it's really bad or really good. Probably do an update about it, including it in my vlog for tomorrow. So there we go, Canucks fans. Tell me what you thought about the overtime shift. What stands out to you the most? Was it one of the plays that the Canucks batted down to keep the puck in? Or was it Hughes's play not only to Demko, but his really nice deke and his almost goal? Was it the actual give and go goal from Toffoli, Toffoli from Horvat? What stood out to you most from that overtime? And I presume that you're happy about it. So leave a comment below. I'd love to read, react, and reply as always. Subscribe if you like to. Like this video if you like to. Enjoy the day. God bless. And go Canucks, go.